Blackstone Audio presents Jack of Spies by David Downing. This book is read by Gildart Jackson. To Nancy. The Blue Dragon. At the foot of the hill, Tsing Dao's government house stood alone on a slight mound, its gabled upper floor windows and elegant corner tower looking out across the rest of the town. Substantial German houses with red tiled roofs peppered the slope leading down to the Pacific beach and pier. Beyond them, the even grander buildings of the commercial district fronted the bay and its harbors. Away to the right, the native township of Taipau Tau offered little in the way of variety. The houses were smaller, perhaps a bit closer together, but more European than classically Chinese. In less than two decades, the Germans had come, organized, and recast this tiny piece of Asia in their own image. Give them half a chance, Jack McColl mused, and they would do the same for the rest of the world. He remembered the Welsh mining engineer leaning over the Moldavia's rail in mid-Indian Ocean and spoiling a beautiful day with tales of the atrocities the Germans had committed in southwest Africa over the last few years. At least 100,000 Africans had perished. Many of the native men had died in battle. Most of the remainder, along with the women and children, had been driven into the desert, where some thoughtful German had already poisoned the waterholes. A few lucky ones had ended up in concentration camps, where a doctor named Fischer had used them for a series of involuntary medical experiments. Children had been injected with smallpox, typhus, tuberculosis. The white man's burden, as conceived in Berlin. McColl had passed two descending Germans on his way up the hill, but the well-kept viewing area had been empty, and there was no sign of other sightseers below. To the east, the hills rose into a jagged horizon, and the earthworks surrounding the 28-centimeter guns on Bismarck Hill were barely visible against the mountains beyond. Some magnification would have helped, but an Englishman training binoculars on foreign defenses was likely to arouse suspicion, and from what he'd seen so far, the guns were where the Admiralty had thought they would be. There was some building work going on near the battery that covered Auguste Victoria Bay, but not on a scale that seemed significant. He might risk a closer look early one morning when the army was still drilling. The East Asia Squadron was where it had been the day before, Scharnhorst and Emden sharing the long jetty, Neisenau and Nuremberg anchored in the bay beyond. Leipzig had been gone a week now, to the Marianas, if his Chinese informer was correct. Several coalers were lined up farther out, and one was unloading by the onshore wharves, sending occasional clouds of black dust up into the clear, cold air. These ships were the reason for his brief visit, these ships and what they might do if war broke out. Their presence was no secret, of course. The local British consul probably played golf with the admiral in command. The same consul could have kept the admiralty informed about Tsing Tao's defences and done his best to pump his German counterpart for military secrets, but of course he hadn't. Such work was considered ungentlemanly by the fools who ran the Foreign Office and staffed its embassies. Not that long ago, a British military attaché had refused to tell his employers in London what he'd witnessed at his host country's military manoeuvres on the grounds that he'd be breaking a confidence. It was left to part-time spies to do the dirty work. Over the last few years, McColl, and he presumed other British businessmen who travelled the world, had been approached and asked to ferret out those secrets the Empire's enemies wanted kept. The man who employed them on this part-time basis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.